Happy Monday, everybody. You're listening to the Personal Playlist Podcast, fondly referred to as the P3. I'm Noah Daniel.
Music is a world within itself, with a language we all understand. With an equal
I am so excited to have Chris Woods here on the Personal Playlist Podcast. Chris has taught math for 20 plus years in Michigan. In addition to his work in the classroom, Chris is also the host of the STEM Everyday Podcast. He produces a weekly one-page newspaper called The Daily STEM to help connect STEM and reading, is a STEM education presenter and trainer, and is the author of the book Daily STEM. Chris loves finding creative ways to inspire her students, especially by adding STEM to his everyday classroom. He believes that inspiration is just as important as instruction and that teaching kids is not just a job, it's the most important job. Welcome to the show, Chris.
Oh, thank you, Noah. I'm so excited to be on the Personal Playlist Podcast. It's exciting.
I'm so happy you're excited. We were just talking before we pressed record about how we met. And to be honest, you engaged in this conversation before one of the On Ed Mentor show, which I also host. And then it was like this incredible privilege that you were actually able to weigh in. So you never know who you're going to meet on Twitter and get to actually engage in meaningful ways. I'm so grateful for that.
Yeah, there's so many great people. And, you know, a lot of people talk about Twitter and other social media as being just, cesspools of negative stuff and politic arguing and things like that. But there's so much great content and ideas for educators and encouragement. We all need that.
I agree with you. And it's also partly how you curate that space and the parts you can control. And it's also how you show up in that space. And I think any digital experience can have negative sides, but can also be a real force of goodness in the world.
Good.
I want to talk a little bit about your book, which is very exciting, by the way. When is it coming out?
It will come out as soon as I finish writing the last couple chapters and get things finished, finished edited, and some people that I know and trust from STEM and making and things like that to read through it and give me some last feedback. Brian Aspinall, author of Blockbreaker, Codebreaker, and his new book Risk Taker, is going to be publishing it. And
that's so exciting.
I'm so excited too, because so often teachers ask me, what do you do? I have to start STEM classes at my school, or we have some grant money for STEM, and what should we do? And there's always so many questions. And I always feel like I want to answer your question and give it all the attention it deserves. But I'm also trying to juggle all these other things that us as teachers juggle. So I feel like this is like the big answer book.
I think that that's so great, because I think that people really do need that big answer, because it requires, it requires design thinking in many ways, and it requires big picture thinking, but also the ability to make things happen and to actualize that vision. So it's great that it's going to be out there, and I'm sure it's something that so many people can use. I know that many people look to you for answers all the time. How did you start doing this?
Honestly, it was because there were great things that I knew I was doing in my classroom to help connect the learning to the real world. And I'm a math teacher. I'm a sciencey person. So I gravitated towards that whole STEM category as soon as that acronym kind of started getting popular. And I talked to my technology teacher at our school, and I said, hey, I've got all these ideas, and I don't want to just share them with my students. I want to make other classrooms better too, because there's other teachers out there that think that, you know, all of rocket science is rocket science. And he said, well, start a Twitter. There's a lot of teachers that use that, and see what happens. So I started sharing some ideas, and then somebody said, hey, do you want to do a podcast? And I said, sure. And then, you know, things just start steamrolling when you're willing to take a few risks and be willing to help people.
I really totally get what you're saying. And it's amazing what happens once you step into that world of sharing, because it changes your community experience, and it adds voice to the things that you've been doing for so long. And it's like a great point for pause and reflection to think about what you're doing and to be open to learning from everybody. It's so fantastic.
I was going to say, in a side note, is my students see the things that I do, and they'll ask me about it. They'll be like, well, how many Twitter followers do you have now, Mr. Woods?
Or a lot.
Think, Yeah, but things like that, and they realize that I'm willing to take a risk, and they're like, "Wow, you're writing a book? What is it about?" And so all of a sudden, these kids that think that STEM is all just like math and science class, all these kids that are reading and kind of literacy type kids are all like, "Oh, wow, that's really cool. What is it like trying to write a book?" And they realize that all these subjects go together.
Yeah, it's an opportunity for that synthesis, but it's also such a great way to model what it is that you're teaching. And I feel the same way, you know, when I started blogging or I started writing about building outside the blocks, my yeah. students asking questions about that and engaging in my work was another way to extend the learning in a more intimate and meaningful way to them. So it's so great that they're following you. They're excited about how many people are following you and that you're continuing to share your ideas. Yeah. This show is about sharing songs. Yeah. So I want to know a little bit about preparing for the show. What was it like for you to choose a nostalgic song, a song that reflects your identity and a song that picks you up?
Wow. So my family loves music. So my kids are teenagers and up. So we love sharing songs with each other. My wife loves songs from way back and my kids like songs from now. And we have this whole eclectic. If you were to look at a playlist on any of our devices, it runs everything. So to try to narrow it down to three songs, I have to tell you, Noah, was a big challenge, but I'm excited for the ones we get to share today.
Okay, well, let's talk about it. So your nostalgic song is one that you called a throwback, which I love. Yeah. Tell me a little bit about that choice and what part of you it tells.
So the throwback song is Johnny Cash's One Piece at a Time. And I love it because for me as a STEM and kind of makerspace and kind of fixing, making, doing kind of teacher, that idea of the whole song idea where he goes to work and he starts bringing parts home in his lunchbox and builds this car out of all the parts that he could bring home from work it shows the kids really and shows anybody really that if you just set your mind to trying to make something, you can make an incredible thing.
Yeah, and it's funny. I was looking at the lyrics thinking about, you know, maker spaces and thinking about what it means to be able to put different things together. And that's in so many ways the value of STEM and thinking that way is being able to take things that seem like separate parts and put them together in a new and exciting way. What does it tell you about your past?
Well, it also, I think, tells me that I really like the idea of just being able to make do with what I've got. My grandparents grew up in the Depression, and I loved hearing stories from their lives and the things that they could do with whatever they had. And I think that's kind of what Mr. Cash was trying to get through a little bit in that song, that, you know, whatever you've got, just make the best of the situation. And you don't have to maybe have the newest, fanciest, best car. If you can put one together from all those pieces and parts that you can scrounge up.
That's so cool. Okay, let's play it. Johnny Cash.
Well, I left Kentucky back in 49 and went to Detroit working on assembly line. The first year they had me putting wheels on Cadillacs. Every day I'd watch them beauties roll by and sometimes I'd hang my head and cry, 'cause I always wanted me one that was long and black. One day I devised myself a plan that should be the envy of most any man. I'd sneak it out of there in a lunchbox in my hand. Now getting caught meant getting fired, but I figured I'd have it all by the time I retired. I'd have me a car worth at least $100,000. I'd get it one piece at a time, and it wouldn't cost me a dime. You'll know it's me when I come through your town. I'm gonna ride around in style, I'm gonna drive everybody wild, 'cause I'll have the only one there is. The very next day when I punched in with my big lunchbox and with help from my friend, I left that day with a lunchbox full of gears. I've never considered myself a thief, but GM wouldn't miss just one little piece, especially if I strung it out over several years. The first day I got me a fuel pump, and the next day I got me an engine and a trunk. Then I got me a transmission and all the chrome. The little things I could get in my big lunchbox, like nuts and bolts and all four shocks. But the big stuff we snuck out my buddy's mobile home.
Yeah. Such a fun and interesting, so Johnny Cash kind of song.
It is. And as a makerspace teacher or a STEM teacher, we often think that we have to have like all the newest, coolest, best stuff that we have to buy. And often we can get all sorts of that kind of making and STEM action going on in our classroom with just that one piece at a time, and it doesn't cost us a dime if we just start looking around and finding the cardboard, the recyclables, the donations that parents and other people are willing to give to our classroom.
Yeah, and the beauty of those found materials can be absolutely new creations coming from things you would have never expected. And that's where STEM becomes so creative. And, you know, people talk about it as a different hemisphere of the brain from literacy a lot of the time, but it's a kind of literacy that we really need to have. And it's an incredible way to join our thinking and to be able to have the ability to use different avenues to get to new directions.
Yeah, you're right, Noah.
Thank you. From you, that means extra a lot. So the next song is your identity song, and different people take it differently, and some people find it the hardest of the three to choose. Tell us a little bit about how you came to it.
Well, I thought this was the easiest song for me to pick, partly because the song is a story about that everyday feeling when you're in school, and just that I want to have some friends. Are these other kids going to like me? And us as educators, we have that incredible opportunity and responsibility to provide those loving and caring opportunities, atmosphere in our classroom for the kids. But also that it's a song from Napoleon Dynamite, and which is just my second favorite movie. And it's just an incredible story of what it's like to just kind of be an awkward kid. And I was that awkward kid. And we can grow up and do incredible things, even just like Napoleon did.
Yeah, just kind of going back to your first song, thinking about the opening sequence where the credits appear and there's all these like everyday items. And that's where you're listening to it. And the fact that it was a surprise hit is probably such a great indicator of how many people can connect to that character and what it means to be quirky in a world where it feels like everybody else knows what they're doing.
Yep. And as educators, we look for that tribe. I mean, Napoleon had Pedro and he had Deb, and it was just like his couple of close friends, and that makes all the difference.
It really does make all the difference. And it's funny, you know, when I first saw your song, I don't know why I kept thinking about a cartoon. And then I realized that Jack Johnson covered it for Curious George. So it has a lot of reach. And I think that it's because there's a simple complexity in the song. Because the truth is, you know, there are lots of easy ways to make friends. And yet it can be one of the hardest things about growing up for so many kids. So it's nice that it's your identity song. What's your first favorite movie?
It's A Wonderful Life.
Okay, awesome. Well, here's The White Stripes. We're going to be friends.
Fall is here, hear the yell. Back to school, ring the bell. Brand new shoes, walking blues. Climb the fence, books and pens.
My toe is tapping. How about you?
Toes tapping. It always does. Like, it's a simple melody and yet it's got so much depth to it. And I was just thinking actually about the reality that so many kids can't learn not numbers and not writing because they're too busy worrying about the social emotional aspects of school. And we treat it like lightly in a similar vein of the mood of the song. And yet there is that complexity and the layers in there about how it's not so easy.
Mm-hmm. And just think of, it's a perfect song for Napoleon Dynamite because he's just that, doesn't quite fit. He's just a little bit different. And, we all have that, whether we want to admit it or not. We're all longing to be loved and cared about by other people. And we need to make sure that we're thinking of all of the kids in our classroom as they're trying to belong. They want to be loved. They want to be cared for. And we have that incredible opportunity to step into their world every day.
We so do. It's funny. I've been doing a lot of reading about self-reg. And for many years, I've been asking the wrong questions about student misbehavior. And I'm learning to ask questions like, what are they really asking for? What mode of belonging are they looking for? Because a lot of the behaviors that we interpret as negative is really their soul trying to cry out for something more that they don't yet know how to ask for. And I think that you're right. Our job is so big when we see it for all that it can be. And it's so important. And both of your songs really, really ground the work that we do because there are so many pieces that we help kids put together. And there are so many ways that we help students learn, and it's not just academic.
And if you haven't watched Napoleon Dynamite or you haven't watched it in a long time, I urge every teacher to watch it again, just because it reminds you and it'll help you see those kids in your classroom in a whole new light.
I'm going to watch it again. I haven't watched it in decades, I don't think.
I watch it at least once a year, if not more.
Well, it sounds like both of your movies are like yearly kind of movies. So that's awesome. Yeah. When did it come out? 2004?
Yeah, it was early 2000s. Yeah.
Okay. So maybe because that's when my first child, I don't know, but I'm gonna, and I will talk about it afterwards. Yeah. I look forward to that. But you sometimes, things can be crazy and hectic and, there's so much that you have that's pulling you in all sorts of directions. And sometimes you just need a pick me up song. Mm-hmm. So I'm not even sure I can do justice to the name of the band. But tell me a little bit about this song and the correct way to pronounce it, if you would, please.
Okay. So the band is Jepacredona. And the song is called Not a Single Cloud. You can find it on YouTube just by searching for Not a Single Cloud. Jepacredona is exactly like it sounds. You probably don't know how to spell it though. It's Finnish. They're a Finnish group. My wife is 100% Finnish. She's like second, third generation being here. And my daughter is in a Finnish folk dance group. And this group came to the United States, to our town, which has a lot of Finnish heritage, a couple of years ago, and did some workshops and taught the kids some dances. And my wife and daughter have actually had the opportunity to go to Finland a couple times to do Finnish dancing. And so it's this song, and there's no words to it. It's just this fabulous, joyful song. And every time it plays, I can picture my daughter and all the other kids in her group dancing. And it's often a wake-up song at our house. So
when you say a wake up song, like you play it and everybody knows it's time to get up, or like everybody wakes up and they're cranky and then you turn this up and everybody rocks out to it.
Yeah, it's more the second one there. And that's always such a good thing for anybody to do, is have like that playlist of songs that just gets the family up and going, or in the classroom, gets your kids up and excited a little bit and feeling like feeling a little bit alive again.
Yeah, the pump up playlist. I love using playlists in my classroom, and it's great to be able to like have those lulls or those transitions to get people in different zones. And music is such a huge part of what I do in the classroom. But every year I try to get students across the school to add to generating a new pick me up playlist so we can play those songs in the morning to start everybody's day in a good way. Yeah. So playlists are certainly powerful. I'm excited to play Jeppo Credona, Not a Single Cloud. Well, I played it before, and it actually got me thinking about grade 9 gym when we learned different folk dances. But it also, it's got like I kind of want to move side to side and move around the classroom and get excited. So I really enjoyed it. Thank you for introducing it to me. How are you feeling about sharing your three songs?
I feel great. Every one of them, I was tapping my feet or I had my eyes closed like in that last song, and I'm picturing my daughter and all the kids dancing and stuff, and it's pretty cool. Thank you. I really appreciate the opportunity to think through those songs and then to share those with you, Noah.
Well, Chris, I really appreciate you spending this time with me. I know that you mentioned your wife and your three kids, but only one of them likes math is something that you wrote to me. How does that feel for a guy like you?
It doesn't bother me. I know that every kid has things that they like better than other things. And I think all my kids know that math, whether they're my own kids or the kids in my classroom, they know that math is important. And even if it's not their favorite subject, that they can still have some fun in math class. That's what I always try to focus on with my kids at school. So
I think that's something that is so important in education, is that we have fun and that learning, even though it's challenging, can also be super exciting and engaging. Is there anything you want to add to the conversation to make sure that people can find you and learn more from you?
Definitely. If somebody wants to find out more about all the different things that I do or the resources that I have, they just have to go to dailystem.com. That's dailystem.com. Real easy. The book, once it's out, is going to be called Daily STEM. Just that idea that STEM is not just another silo of education. It's not just another thing that we pull it out and say, okay, the kids, it's time for STEM, and then we put it away. Or they go to the STEM lab, and then they come back to our classroom where we don't do STEM anymore. It really needs to be something that we see connected to the world every day, and especially connected to literacy. That's why I've been making those one-page newspapers for educators for about the last year now.
When you have the idea to make the newsletters, because I check them out often, is it something that happens at school that's the catalyst, or a question that people ask you? What's the most prominent way that you have the idea for what you're going to write about?
I'm constantly always just looking around me and seeing the things in my world, whether that's when I'm reading the news on my, whatever news websites that I'm on, or just thinking through cool challenges and activities and things like that. And just thinking about how my students have all these different interests and passions. And it's up to me, it's up to us as educators to show them that there is a reason why they're learning these things. That the math and the science and the technology, engineering, it all connects somehow to the things that they're interested in. And that's why I really try to pick a wide variety of interesting articles and ideas and different things that connect. And then I put them in that weekly newsletter.
It's awesome. And, in so many ways, your three songs connect to so many aspects of your life. And that life includes being an educator and being so deeply committed to your work. I want to thank you so much for spending this time with me.
Definitely.
Hopefully we'll get a chance to connect again and maybe get you on another On Ed Mentor show.
Yeah, definitely. I always love talking about STEM, and especially I love helping other educators find out great ideas for their classrooms.
So I am that educator who is always looking for great ideas, and especially because I only teach homeroom, so I only really teach literacy and math, and well, in the classroom that I have right now, and health and dance and drama. It's so fun for me to try to find creative ways in and try to connect with the science teacher or the geography history teacher to do something more holistic. And I think that it's exactly what you're saying. You're not doing it only in this class. And it's such an important opportunity for kids to feel the connection to all those subjects. And that's why STEM as an acronym is important, although I'm more of a STEAM person.
Yep. Oh, I am too, but I naturally see those arts in all of the STEMs. So for me,
adding it as implied. I like it.
It's almost redundant to say it in my mind, because it's just there. You can't separate. It's like peanut butter and jelly. You can't separate the two. They're together, the STEM and the arts. So
I really like that. I'm gonna think about that. Anyway, I want to thank you again so much. I hope you have the most wonderful day.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you, Noah, again for having me on, and keep up the good work on your podcast.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us on the P3, the Personal Playlist Podcast. I'm Noah Daniel. This is Voice Ed Radio, and I hope you have a fantastic day.